let's make our jobs about climate change. No, instead, let's make our job climate change. As I get ready to apply for college, I ask the usual questions. What do I like? And what education will set me up to make a difference? When I ask these questions, I need to consider what the future will hold and the path that we're taking towards it. Gone are the days when wearing a fur coat or flying your private jet to a party is considered cool. Taylor Swift got the internet's attention when it was reported that she flew 170 times in just the past few months. Drake saw some drama when it was reported that he flew for just 14 minutes from Hamilton, Ontario to Toronto. Sustainability as a theme has moved from the eclectic to the mainstream, and the delicate nature of our planet is in focus for the first time in mankind. Millennials will make up about 3/4 of the workforce by 2030. So what will they think about businesses that don't consider sustainability? Let's look at these statistics. In a recent study, it was found that 70% of millennials were more likely to choose to work at a company with a strong environmental agenda. But only 25% of Gen X and 17% of baby boomers would make that same choice. We need institutions that will feed this desire for the generations to come, and much progress has been made. But I've been working on an idea of my own. The middle school that I attended, the alternative school for math and science, incorporated scientific inquiry into their curriculum through required participation in national science competitions. So, as a part of this coursework, I took to the internet to find a project. But it didn't take me long. One theme stuck out to me. It was everywhere. Climate change. As I'd sit at the dinner table and watch the news, mostly clueless about what was actually happening, I couldn't help but pick up on the issue at the forefront. Debates would go back and forth between parties and people like Greta Thunberg on whether climate change was real, whether it mattered, and what we needed to do. I didn't want to scream, but I also didn't want to not listen. I then realized that I wanted to find a solution. Thus began my journey that I hope to share with you today and how it may shape the path that we can all take in the future. I looked into current solutions for climate change and saw what you'd expect. Plant trees, use public transportation, use green energy, electric cars, and you can all name the rest. But what I didn't expect to see was a Forbes article on a technology called direct air capture. Direct air capture means capturing carbon dioxide directly from the air we have outside, commonly in large industrial plants with these huge blowers. The carbon dioxide can be consumed, or it can be permanently stored underground after being turned into natural volcanic rock. As I read about this, I found this system to be very similar to recycling. You take some waste product, capture it, and turn it into something else. So, you all know that recycling has been widely adopted in many parts of the world, but did you know that it isn't just something that sprung about in the last few decades? World War II was the beginning of massive, universal collection campaigns for tin, rubber, steel, paper, and more. More than 400,000 people volunteered in the effort, and tens of thousands of tons of material was recycled to save money for the war. It truly was a national campaign. All Americans were on board, and most were excited to help aid the troops by conserving and recycling. Now, I of course don't want to liken climate change to World War, but I was inspired by the parallels. We found unity in working together to fight a common problem, and many of us were proud to have made a difference. I then realized the solution to climate change must lie in getting more people engaged and feeling proud of the difference that they have made. So maybe we could try recycling again, but this time for carbon dioxide. Everybody could do a little recycling. My idea was a small box inside your house that would capture carbon dioxide. Each week, it would be recycled at the curb along with your traditional recycling and garbage. It would be taken to a county facility where it could be heated to 100 degrees Celsius and release all that CO2 and then returned back to the house for further capture. I called this process ICART, or Integrative Carbon Reduction Technology. I started small. My first experiments were in my kitchen, boiling red cabbage as a pH indicator and poking plastic straws through water bottles and Diet Coke for carbon dioxide. I even made an animation with Legos to demonstrate my idea to whoever was crazy enough to listen to it. Eventually, I found a real position at a lab at Cornell University, where I tested many fabric-like substrates, hoping to find one with the perfect combination of cost, capture capacity, and reusability. At first, I didn't get good data. I just kept getting this one number that wouldn't impress, 0.25, 0.2, 0.3, 0.2 again, but it wasn't the number I was so interested in. It wasn't the capture material I was so invested in finding. It was the idea. It was the idea of crowdsourcing carbon capture. It was the idea of uniting us against a common problem, and it was the idea of change. And so I kept going. Why isn't it working? What am I doing wrong? I developed a new testing procedure, and finally that number started going up. 0.25, 1.2, 3.1, and finally I had the golden number. 3.1 millimoles of CO2 per gram of substrate. That was kind of anticlimactic. I know that doesn't really mean much, but 3.1 was the highest reported carbon dioxide capture capacity in all current literature. And it was all done with a relatively simple fabric, cotton. I went on to present my data and analysis at the Regeneron International Science and Engineering Fair, where I won the first grand award in the category of chemistry. I even filed a patent, and I could finally say that my big idea was coming to life. So, what does all this geeky science mean? One subscriber to the ICART system that I proposed would have the capture potential of planting 125 trees. Altogether, this could mean the capture of 2 gigatons of CO2. So, what do we need to make green technologies like ICART succeed? We would need material science and nanoscale understanding to improve efficiency and robustness. We would need chemical engineering to understand the rates of this capture, and we would need systems engineering to ensure synergies, minimize penalties, and understand the system as a whole. So I want to leave you all with one question. If ideas like ICART are technically feasible and enable you to contribute to the sustainability of our planet, would you make that change? Thank you.